Barakallah Fik, brother, and the entire team at ICK. Jazakallah khair for the warm hospitality and the welcome. And everybody else, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. Alhamdulillah rabbil alameen, wa salatu wa salam rasul al-kareem wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in, amma ba'd. Fa'udhu billahi minash shaitani rajeem, bismillahir rahmanir rahim. We thank Allah azza wa jal, we praise him and we seek his guidance. To him we all belong. Peace and blessings be on all the prophets and on the final prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and all those who follow in righteousness. Today, another special Jummah, another beautiful occasion, another session where we could reconnect, boost our iman, share. And of all these sessions I've taken, perhaps this is something that is very close to my heart. Yes, I am an educationist, so I talk a lot about education, parenting. Children are the forte I speak about so much, and their careers and what can we do with the schoolings. But at some point of time, you realize all that is because of one thing that you are so passionate about. And that is the sunnah. That is the love of this deen. And the love of deen for me came by reading virtue of my first book I read on seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the topic that I have for you is called 5 ways to love Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Without being very technical, it is a beautiful topic in the sense that we all have heard about the various stories and the love of the Sahabas and how can you increase the love, the duruds that you do. Today, I thought I'll just make it more academic. That is what I am. And how does a teacher teach a student? Inshallah, for the next hour, be my students. Let's see the way we would love to love Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And I've got 5 ways with examples and stories from people around him. And hopefully, by the end of this webinar, if your love and my love increases even by an inch towards our Nabi, towards the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, I think we would have done ourselves a great favor. So there we go, alhamdulillah. And yes, because it is such a special occasion, and of course, you know, I love to come here and spend some time. Very difficult to refuse, Brother Rafiq and all the team at ICK, because I look forward to come to Kuwait and the hospitality. I felt that there is a joy in speaking about this session. You know, I dress up for the occasion. I put my oud on because it's the Jummah Sunnah, isn't it? And how amazing is this Jummah Sunnah when you couple it talking about the person whom Allah says that if you send durood on him, if you send salams on him, subhanallah, it enhances. It's one of the virtues, one of the sunnahs, one of the to do's of the Friday. I'm sure today with the lockdown open up, you've gone for your Jummahs, you've attended the Khatib, the khutbah is there, and come back, perhaps had your lunch. So let's enjoy what this day tells us about. I'll tell you a small incident before we begin. And this incident is about a sahabi whose name is Khubayb. Khubayb ibn Khabbab radiallahu ta'ala. Khubayb radiallahu ta'ala, as with any sahabas, his heart was filled with love of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But because he was a poor man who could not emigrate, could not do hijrah to Medina, he had to stay back in Makkah. And as he's in Makkah, the Quraysh, the top notch of the Quraysh, from Umayyah bin Khalaf and Abu Jahl and Walid ibn Mughira and the people around, they caught him and said, we will do a public execution of this man to show and send a message to the people in Medina. Essentially, they wanted to scare and humiliate the Muslim. So here is Khubayb right in front of the Kaaba, about to be executed in public. And as always, you know, this custom of last wish was granted upon and said, oh, Khubayb, do you have anything to say as of now? Imagine, now Khubayb is making a public statement in Makkah. People from all tribes are watching, his eyes on him, and the Quraysh are expecting that he will say something really nasty and bad. So the first question is that is asked to Khubayb is, Khubayb, don't you think that if you wish, your messenger would be in your place, if Muhammad were here instead of you being executed? And Khubayb smiles. And Khubayb says, you know what I wish for really? All I wish for is I wish Allah had given me 100 souls, each of them for Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And that itself is a victory for the young Muslim crowd that was just growing up, subhanallah. And Khubayb said, oh Allah, you be a witness that I send my salams upon Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it is said in the authentic riwayas, in the authentic narration, it was about Maghrib when Khubayb said that. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is sitting in Masjid al-Nabi in the Maghrib time. And he replies, and upon to you, O Khubayb. Subhanallah. Think about it. A man in Makkah being executed wants to sacrifice hundreds of his souls only for the love he has for his Nabi. And Allah sends the message and Rasulullah replies to him. This, my brothers and sisters, is what I mean by loving Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Does your love increase inch by inch, centimeter by centimeter, a little by little as we go ahead? I think that is the purpose. I'm not here to tell you technical things. I'm here to tell you, how do I expand my heart to put this love of my Nabi in it? Subhanallah. So this is what I will do, is the 5 gems, as I say, that will increase your love for Rasulullah is what we'll be sharing in this webinar. Love has degrees. There are different levels of love. A love for, you know, your cousin's child is different than a love for your child. A love for the mother for her own child is different when the child is sick and when the child is healthy. That's different, the variation of love. Where do you stand at? If I were to ask you on a scale of 10, how much do you love Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Perhaps each one would have said 10 out of 10. But then when we ask ourselves questions, what have we done? Is the love a verbal love, or love is actually being implemented? We'll know where we stand. So here is a journey of true love. As I said, 5 ways to love Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. These are the 5 ways. When you say you love him, when you say you love and he is the beloved to you, how much do you know him? You know, for that matter, when I say I love my spouse or I love my daughters, subhanallah, the first thing is, do I even know about them? Know what do the name mean, where are they for, what classes they study in. And sometimes, you know, you ask a father what's the date of birth for your child and they are a little lost. Which grade is your child in? And they are not very sure. That means we know very little about it. Step number 2, when you truly love somebody, there's something about them that should catch your attention, that should hold your attention, that should grab your attention. Are we doing that with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Step number 3, the intensity. You know, these are the degrees of love. The intensity of love, as the Arabs call it, the hub. The hub expands, the love expands. Do you really miss somebody? You know, if you were away from your spouse, it says distance create love. Do you really miss them? You WhatsApp them, you send them some messages, you call them. Or your parents who are away, if you're sitting in Kuwait and the loved members are not there, especially in the COVID-19 that you saw, what did you do? Do you miss Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? And if you do, how do you show that? Step number 4, you love them, right? You say you love Rasulullah. What's your contribution to that love? What's the efforts you put in? And that is a question we'll be asking ourselves. And finally, the 5th step, the 5th gem that I'll be sharing with you is something called together forever. Do you wish to reunite? Do you wish to meet him again? Do you wish to shake his hand? Do you wish to walk alongside him? This is the love I'm talking about. These are the 5 ways you love anybody. But for that matter, the most important personality, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةُ الْحَسَنَةِ. Indeed, in the messenger of Allah is the best example. Do we really love this example Allah has set us for? So this is a journey I'll be taking you about. And here we start our step number 1. What is Islam? You know, this is a question that scholars have asked, philosophers have asked, the Mufassireen have asked, the people who have translated and wrote commentaries on the Quran. But one of the most touching answer was by Imam Suyuti, a great late 17th century scholar. The Imam Suyuti was asked, what is Islam? And he said, everything that concerns Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is deen. Anything that touches Rasulullah is deen. Anything that he is not a part of is not deen. And I love the definition. I loved it. There is nothing that went away. If you wake up and you say the dua that was taught by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, that is Islam. As I smile to you, which is sadaqah, and we'll talk about it, this is Islam. My salah, قُلْ إِنَّ السَّلَاتِ وَنُسُكِ وَمَحْيَايَ وَمَمَاتِ لِلَّهِ رَبِّ الْعَالَمِينَ. The entire pattern that you do for Allah Azza wa Jal is the path that you have taken is shown by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. قُلْ إِنَّ السَّلَاتِ وَنُسُكِ. Indeed, my salah and my sacrifice and my life and my death are for Allah Azza wa Jal. This is what Rasulullah taught us, subhanallah. So this is Islam. And Allah Azza wa Jal says, what is Islam? Allah says, وَأَتِيُوا اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُ لَعَلَّكُمْ تُرْحَمُونَ. Indeed, obey Allah. أَتِيُوا اللَّهُ وَرَسُولُ. obey Allah and His Messenger that you may find mercy. Tarhamun, you know, the world today is struggling with this whole epidemic called mental health, which to me is a bigger epidemic than the corona. Because corona, you have a vaccine for it. You might find it soon and the world will be back to the normal. You'll forget that you ever were in a lockdown. We forget the hard times so easily, isn't it? But indeed, the mental health, that we all are prisoners of our mind, anxiety, depression, short-temperedness, a lot of things that come across. What are we doing about it? Allah says, this is it. Allah says, you want rahmah, you want peace, you want a state of bliss? Obey Allah and His Messenger, and trust me, you will find that bliss. So, subhanAllah, my step one was, you say you love Rasulullah, don't you? So find out, go out and tell me about the lineage of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now today, they call it a United States issue, and I say this is a problem across. Children do not know the names beyond their grandfathers. Go back and ask your own daughters and son. And who are the grandfathers? And if they are not even living with them, they don't know how did the grandfather behave, the grandmothers. And a step backward, do we know them? Do you know? You love Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In the United States, people, they say they do not know their father, Steve Jobs. And that's a sad word. You know, and Jeff Bezos, he's an adopted son and he have not met his father until he became 40 years old. That's a sad state. Subhanallah. But when we talk about that sad state, what about us? The most important personality in your life, how many lineage, how much of his genealogy do you know of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? From him, Muhammad ibn Abdullah ibn Abdul Muttalib, and where does it end? Go ahead, use your chats and tell me, impress me, my brothers and sisters. I would love to know how much of the genealogy of Rasulullah do you know? I really would like to know, where do we stand when you talk about our own Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Are we there somewhere? And I'm not sure if I can read your chats right now, if they're enabled or not, but here we go. You know, if you are talking about Rasulullah's family tree, and we say we love him, right? How much do we know? Here we are. Let's learn something new. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Ibn Abdullah, Ibn Abdul Muttalib, who's also called Shaiba because of the grayness of his hair. Ibn Hisham, Hashim comes from the time they used to make, you know, break their bread and make and put it in the soup for the hajis, for the pilgrimage, for the pilgrims who come in. Ibn Abd Manaf, Ibn Qusay, Ibn Khilab. I mean, it's not a matter of just learning it. In the classes I take, I make these trains and I ask the children to reassemble the train bogies. How much do you know? Oh, okay, if you do not know the lineage, you say, brother Dawood, this is so difficult, you're asking me. How about the wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? They are Ummahatul Mu'mineen, right? They are the mothers of the believer, and you are a believer, isn't it? So do you know your mother's name? Not your biological mother, I'm talking about the mothers that Allah azza wa jal honor, the Ummahatul Mu'mineen. Do you know Khadija and Aisha and Zainab and Safiya and Hafsa and another Zainab? And Maimuna, how many do you know? And Ummah, where are we? Subhanallah. Ummah Rumaysa, or the daughter of Abu Sufyan. Subhanallah. Do you know the wives, the 11 in all of them? Where are we talking about? Okay, let me make it even easier for you. You love Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, don't you? Tell me the 5 names of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Let me see if I can stop the screen share and see. Okay, alhamdulillah, I can see your chats now, hopefully. Tell me the 5 names of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You can use your chats or the way the organizing team can decide. I would love to know from you. What are the names of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? You know, when I ask this question to a lot of people, I get names like Muzammil, Mudassir. Yes, these are the laqab. These are the titles, like Amin, As-Sadiq is a title. Ya ayyul muzammil, qum fa'anzir, wa rabbaka faqabbir. These are titles. Ya ayyul muzammil, qum illayla illa qaleela, nisfahu, aw inqus minhu qaleela. These are, Allah is attributing Rasulullah to, and encouraging to do something. But the 5 names of Rasulullah, as in the hadith of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as in the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself, he said, Allah call me Muhammad, and Allah call me Ahmed. So these are the 2 names you and I are very, very, it's a very common name, right? Then Allah called me Mahi, Allah called me Hashir, and Allah called me Aqib. What they mean, Mahi, Hashir, and Akib, these are from the authentic riwayas. Muhammad means someone who prays. Ahmad means someone who's praiseworthy. Mahi is someone, subhanAllah, the end. Akib is the final. And Hashir is someone who will be gathered. Mahi actually also means the destroyer. He is one who will destroy the evil, destroy the shirk. And these, you know, when you want to love Rasulullah, these are the words I use. That do you know even him by his names, by his wives, by his lineage? And that is what we're talking about. Oh, by the way, here is a small incident. You know how much Allah loves Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? He loves him so much, he does not even want his name to be, you know, just to be adulterated a little. Little tarnish on the name, and Allah does not like it. So there was this lady, and we know her as the wife Abu Lahab, as in Tabbat Yada Abi Lahab, right? Her name was Jamil or Al-Awra. Al-Awra means cockeyed. Look at Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, the one who wanted to malign Rasulullah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala maligned her instead. So she would always, you know, refer to Rasulullah in a slang way, in a very degrading manner by calling him Mudammam. So she will say something bad, but because her tongue was rolled up, she would say, oh, Mudammam did this and Mudammam did that. And the Sahabas, the companions of Rasulullah, would be so upset, and they would come and say, Ya Rasulullah, this lady is calling you by evil names. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam would smile and say, I am Muhammad. She knows she's calling somebody who's Mudammam. Amazing, isn't it? Mudammam and Muhammad, there's a world of a difference. And this is what we're talking about. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not even want the name to be tarnished, and he changed the tongue. He twisted the tongue of the lady who wanted to call him by his evil name. So sometimes you and I are so scared what's going to happen to Rasulullah. Somebody, you know, sketches a caricature and we are on taking arms. Allah will protect. What are you doing to protect yourself from, you know, ku anfusikum wa ahlikum nara? You do that, you follow the commandments, save yourself and your family from the fire. Allah will protect the name of honor. Oh, what better honor to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? You know, somebody asked me, which is the best seerah of Rasulullah? Which is the best seerah? And trust me, you know, all I said is open the Quran. And I'm not talking about the hadith of Aisha radiallahu ta'ala, which I'll talk about. I said, just read Juz Amma, the 30th, the final Juz. Every story, every surah is a reflection of some incident, some story of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You want to know what about his birth? Read about Surah Dua. وَالْدُّهَا وَاللَّيْلِ إِذَا سَجَى. And Allah will talk about فَأَمَّا الْيَتِيمَ فَلَا تَأْخَرْ. Or you want to know about the year he was born? Surah Fil. Talk about Surah Fil. أَلَمْ تَرَ كَيْفَ فَعَلَ رَبُّكَ بِأَصْحَابِ الْفِيلِ. And you know everything about the birth of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You want to talk about his city he was born in? Read Surah Teen. وَالتِّين وَالزَّيْتُونَ وَالتُّورِ سِينَانَ وَحَازَ الْبَلَدِ الْأَمِينَ, which is referring to Makkah. You want to talk about what happens when Allah will give him, when people are talking evil about him? Surah Kawthar. إِنَّا آتَيْنَكَ الْكَوْثَرَ. Allah says, I've gifted him the Kawthar. You want to talk about, you want to talk about what happens to his enemy? Surah Lahab. You want to talk about his tribe? Surah Quraysh. You want to talk about when he gets angry? Surah Abasa. You want to talk about his victory? Surah An-Nasr. You want to talk about the power Allah gave him? Surah Qadr. Juz Amma is nothing but the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Musa alayhi salam, one of my favorite prophets, along with Dawood, of course, I love him because I share the name with this beautiful prophet. But Musa requested Allah. He said, Allah, you know, Musa alayhi salam says, is, oh Allah, rabbish rahli sadri wa yassirli amri. Allah, open my heart and give me knowledge. For Rasulullah, Allah says, Alam nashra laka sadrak wa badana anka wizrak. I have opened your heart. The surahs in Juz Amma are nothing but the seerah of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I repeat, the surahs in Juz Amma are the seerahs of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How much you love Rasulullah, not the surahs, check up, and it's an assignment for you. Read Surah At-Tariq and you will know what happens, what is the end of those who are enemies, who fight, who try to defame Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and that is what will console you. You don't have to take up arms, you don't have to throw stones. All you have to do is put your effort in loving Rasulullah more, and Allah will elevate you because he's already elevated Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the first lesson in the first love is the Quran is the answer to the lives we are living. You know, the loving of Rasulullah, step one is open the Quran, read about the Prophet, read the message he came with. And this is a reminder for all of us. Let's go to number two. And I wish I could, you know, play a lot of videos and play along. But inshallah, I'm keeping the process around. Inshallah, if someday I'll do a Thursday evening, I'll play videos. Inshallah, and we'll do a little longer version of what I'm talking to you today. The second thing is, what catches your attention? What, at the end of the day, what are you thinking? You know, I do a lot of mindset coaching, and I keep telling people, you notice things that you're worried about or you're holding, you know, your setback. Let's say today, if you were driving and your car had a little dent, you know, you hit somewhere, every single car that you look, you'll be searching for the dent there. It's self-satisfaction, you know, it's a kind of ego booster. Oh, I'm not alone. Imagine if you had a sock that was torn, or somewhere along the line, your hijab was torn. You just look for validation. You look at torn hijabs. Your specs are not good. You look at that. You know, you want to hear answers. You want to buy something, mobile phone, you check everybody's mobile phone. Shoes, you check everybody's shoes. That's what catches your attention. For the Sahabas, the only thing that caught attention is anything to do with Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The scene is of a battle. The most important, the first battle, the Battle of Badr. Here are 300 young Sahabas. I say young because they're fresh in terms of the deen. They've just migrated to Medina, fighting an enemy three times their size. Abdul Rahman bin Auf, radiallahu ta'ala an, one of the Ashra Mubashiras, is given two young boys, the Umairs as they call him, or the Muadains they call him. And he's not sure what to do with his young boys until one of them pull his thawb and it says, Ya Ummi, O uncle, show me who Abu Jahl is. And the other one says, Ya Uncle, show me who Abu Jahl is. And Abdul Rahman bin Auf says, what is happening to these young teenage boys? They are the Ansar children. They are the children in Medina. They have not lived the Makkan life. Why are they asking for Abu Jahl? They don't know who Abu Jahl is. Amr bin Hisham, right? Abu Jahl. And they ask him, why? And Abdul Rahman, of course, had to decode, go back and said, you know, the only thing Abdul Rahman did is pointed to Abu Jahl. And he says, I'm not sure if my finger was quicker or the boys who flew like falcons on Abu Jahl and they killed him, along with Abdullah ibn Masud, as the riwayah says. Why? Why was it intense enmity and hatred against this enemy of Islam in these young teenage Madini boys or Ansari boys? They had not seen the harsh 13 years of Makkah. It is because the parents, the Ansars of Medina, were telling stories of Rasulullah, how he was tortured by this man, Abu Jahl. Being a relative, he was the first and the foremost to humiliate, malign, and torture Rasulullah. And they were filled with venom. They wanted to seek revenge for Rasulullah in a legal battlefield. Not now that they're talking about, subhanAllah. Why? Because somebody was telling stories of Rasulullah. What kind of stories do you tell your children? What kind of lessons you build up in home? Allah says in Surah At-Tawbah, قُلْ إِنْ كَانَ آبَاؤُكُمْ وَأَبْنَاؤُكُمْ وَإِخْوَانُكُمْ وَأَزْوَاجُكُمْ وَعَشِيرَتُكُمْ وَأَمْوَالٌ اقْتَرَفْتُمُوهَا وَتِجَارَةً تَخْشَوْنَ قَصَادَهَا وَمَسَاكِينَ تَرْضَوْنَهَا أَحَبَّ إِلَيْكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ فَتَرَبَّصُوا حَتَّى يَأْتِيَ اللَّهُ بِأَمْرِهِ وَاللَّهُ لَا يَهْدِي الْقَوْمَ الْفَاسِقِينَ. Allah Azza wa Jal says that if you love the worldly things, your fathers and your brothers and your wealth and your houses and your horses, your vehicles, your Pajeros and your BMWs and your Audis and whatever cars you are driving, the Hondas, the Hyundais, more than Allah and His Rasul and fighting in His cause. أَحَبَّ إِلَيْكُم مِنَ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولِهِ وَجِهَادٍ فِي سَبِيلِهِ فَتَرَبَّصُوا. Allah said, then wait. Wait for the punishment of Allah, because the lives we are leading are so materialistic. You know, we've forgotten the joy of loving our Prophet. We've forgotten the joy of immersing ourselves in the lessons of Seerah. And that is what we're talking about. There was a man in Medina whose name they referred to as Abdullah ibn Himar, Abdullah the donkey. I'm amazed at this story in Bukhari. And because he was drinking, he had a problem. He was an alcohol addict, right? Sahabi of Rasulullah. But yes, he was an alcoholic. So Abdullah ibn Himar would be flogged because that is a punishment for drinking alcohol there. But then one of the Sahabas, after flogging him, cursed him. He said, she said something nasty about Abdullah. And then Rasulullah said, do not curse him, for I swear by Allah, I know that he loves Allah and His Messenger. An alcoholic is defended by Rasulullah because he loves Allah and His Messenger. You and I, with the baggages and sacks of sin, do we even come and close and say, Allah, I ask your forgiveness because I love your Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. How much do you love? Oh, my brothers and sisters, shame on us. More than us is an inanimate tree trunk who loves Rasulullah. The famous story in Medina where Rasulullah used to give the khutbah standing on a tree trunk. And then one day the complaints came, and of course the women and the couple they made a subhanallah, a small podium, a small, the for the Jummah as you stand up for. And then as Rasulullah was about to commence his speech, there was a sound that he could see as if someone's crying. And everyone's puzzled, who's crying here? And Rasulullah got down from the mimbar, the podium, and he went and he patted the tree trunk that he saw. The only trunk that was left. And Rasulullah said, I promise you, you will be my palm tree in Jannah. And the trunk stopped crying. The trunk stopped crying. And Rasulullah said, I swear by Allah, had I not promised this prophecy to the tree trunk, you would have heard the tree trunk cry till Qiyamah. You would have gone to Medina, my brothers and sisters, like the Zamzam miracle, you would have seen the miracle of the tree trunk as well. An inanimate, a trunk, a lifeless object is crying because it misses Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When was the last time you cried because you missed Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? When was it? The stones and the pebbles and the animals are better than me and you because we hardly love. We hardly even express that desire of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهَ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبُكُمْ اللَّهُ وَيُغْفِرْ لَكُمْ وَذُنُوبَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Indeed, if you love Allah and His Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Allah says, I'll forgive all your sins. Allah is the most forgiving. Allah is the most merciful. Don't you want your sins to be forgiven? Go back and express your love. Blog, poems, share the stories, tell people about it. You know, I was living in the Gulf when the Danish cartoon series came in. And I realized there were three kind of reaction to it. One was a very vile, un-Rasulullah-like reaction. People going on rampage and killing and shooting, which is not what Rasulullah would recommend. And the other one was equally appalling, which was a silent treatment. We decided it's nothing to do with us. We will not do anything. We'll read the newspapers. We'll not comment because the society we're living in, we can't express ourselves. Shame on that. Both treatments. But there was one which was an active statement. We started working on telling people about Seerah, printing the books of Seerah, telling stories. Wallahi al-Azim, I went, and this is my work with schools and education, I went and asked every single school I knew. I said, would you allow me to speak about my prophet? These are schools with people from all faith. I went to the length and breadth of the nation. I went and spoke, and all I did was I could convey the message of Rasulullah. Speak about hadith. Tell the word Rasulullah, print books on Seerah, write blogs and poems. This is how you show the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, remember the famous hadith of Umar bin al-Khattab radiallahu ta'ala. He says, Ya Rasulullah, I love you except for myself, everyone else are secondary. And Rasulullah said, Umar, recheck your iman. Umar bin Khattab, who knows what he's talking about, Rasulullah asked him to recalibrate his iman, because if you do not love Rasulullah more than yourself, your iman is on a shaky ground. I'm really, really scared about us. What about you and me? Where do we stand? Subhanallah, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam deserves that kind of a love. So as we are talking about, increase in your ibadah. My second step, as you say, increase in the knowledge of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Start telling small seerah stories. You know, I've done a small series on called 20 hadith. Do a small hadith as bedtime stories to the children. Tell them these hadith. Tell them about Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I've done an entire seerah series. There are some great people around. There are audio lectures for children and adults on seerah. Go read them. Go on a podcast and listen to them as you are at home. Play it in the speakers. That's what we're asking you. And remember, the season is here. And what season am I talking about? Ramadan is around 100 days more, isn't it? You're almost there in Ramadan. How are you going to prepare yourself? So these are the first two lessons. Knowing Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Let's go to my step three. My step three is, how much do you miss someone? You know, subhanallah, the best way to love Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam is his manners. How much do you know about manners of Rasulullah? If you look at 1/3 of the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they are about his akhlaq, they are about his character, his smiling, his walking, his rifq. Rifq is a word for gentleness, his kindness, his sadaqah. He's giving away. There was a Bedouin who came in and he says, and he grabbed Rasulullah by the collar. And so much so that there was a red line on his neck. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was shocked. He said, what are you doing to me? And the Bedouin says, Muhammad, give me all the sheep and the goat that you have. I want it. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, no, by Allah, I will not give you. You've been harsh to me. and the Bedouin, and the Bedouin, I swear by Allah, I know you will give me. Strange, right? Rasulullah says, I will not give you. The Bedouin was harsh. The Bedouin was aggressive on Rasulullah. And the Bedouin says, I swear by Allah, I know you will give me. And Rasulullah says, Kaif, how is it possible? He says, you never return a harm with a harm. You always repel an evil with good deed. So he's telling Rasulullah, you always repel a evil deed, which is what he did, the Bedouin did, with a good deed. And Rasulullah smiled. Rasulullah was smiling. He says, give this Bedouin what he wants. Hadith, the manners. How are you doing your sadaqah? How are you greeting people and the neighbors who will not be good to you or your children? You go and give a box of, what is it, Ferrero Rocher to them? That would be nice. Imagine the akhlaq. You know, there was a Syrian family who was living next door. They just migrated, or rather emigrated, to United States, and they were living there in United States, and nobody liked them, right? The Syrian lady, they all different, the women with hijab. And these ladies, the Syrian family, had two young boys. There was an old, this is about a British story. So the old British, you know, I heard stories about Britishers sometimes being very snobbish. No, I'm not making a statement, but the story has this. The snobbish old lady had a garden, which was all ransacked with weeds and overflowing grasses. So the Syrian family, the mother said, go to the neighbor and cut down and mow the lawn. And they kept doing it over and over and over again. This lady would always be, you know, not nice to them, grumble and not even smile at them. But the family always did that. After perhaps a month or so, the old lady comes home. The old British lady comes home and says, I never knew you could be so good family. If Islam teaches you this, I want to become a Muslim. I think your akhlaq is the best determination of who you are. You know, I keep saying, in the Gulf especially, how you drive your car is the representation of what deen you follow. Now look at it. How you drive your car is a representation of the deen, of the faith you follow. Subhanallah, every single Muslim in the entire Arab world is an ambassador behind wheels. Because that's how we become, right? We become strange creatures when we have wheels in front. Please do not embarrass the religion of Allah Azza wa Jal. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his akhlaq was, you know, Aisha Siddiqa radiallahu ta'ala anha, she was a teenager when she got married. So a sahabi came and asked, what is the character of Rasulullah like? And Aisha, instead of replying with a proper, you know, summary answer, she said, have you not read the Quran? His character was the Quran. Imagine, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam was the walking Quran. And I spoke about it. The akhlaq that he took, the manners he took, was from the Quran. I'll give you one of his character about smiling. You know, we keep hearing about smiling as a charity, don't we? But somehow we forget that the moment the word charity comes in, we think of putting a hand in the pocket and they never come out. We are so, so reluctant and we don't smile. In the lockdown, the last 8 months you are with your family, how many times you smile at your children, your wife, your parents, who if you're blessed to live with them? How many times we smile at each other on Zoom? Oh, we don't even turn the camera on. We are so strange. We think we are so photogenic, others should not look at us. Well, you have your etiquettes and hijab. I'm a teacher and I tell my teachers, this is the time you have to invite people to the houses. You are a guest in my family. So what you look behind is how my house is. If somebody to walk behind by mistake, it's okay. It's okay. I don't come around. Please, this is the akhlaq. When you are in my house, you don't roam around and look at what my ceilings are or how many cobwebs I've got. Please allow them. Allow that expression. And this is what Islam is. This is the akhlaq of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It's the charity we're talking about. You know, it's a simple act. I keep saying to my students, the only time you don't smile is either you have not brushed your teeth or you are a miser, a very, very sad man. And I hope we are not both of them. The akhlaq of Rasulullah. Do you know how Rasulullah looked like? Imagine, subhanAllah, how would Rasulullah look like? Ubay bin Al-Qab, or subhanAllah, you know, the people, the sahabas who were asked to describe Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said his face was like moon, like a full glowing moon on this beautiful night, and that is how they would describe. Read the Shimail of Rasulullah, Shimail al-Tirmidhi, that they describe the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Talk to people who have, you know, sacrificed themselves for this man, Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Let me tell you, the heart of this talk was based on a statement by this sahabi, Sa'd al-Aswad radiallahu ta'ala an. And this is the only longer story I want to really tell you. Sa'd al-Aswad says something called, Fidaka abi wa ummi ya Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. What it means is fidaka, you know, may in Urdu it comes out way better, but I'll try to translate it. Fidaka abhi wa ummi, may my parents be sacrificed, may my parents be ransacked. May, you know, this is a statement the Arabs would say. I would rather give away my parents to protect you, O Rasulullah. Fidaka abhi wa ummi ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What's the background of statement? Let me tell you this incident. Subhanallah, Sa'd al-Aswad, as the name says, you know, we learned about, you know, Abdullah ibn Himar. So this is another title we're talking about. Sa'd al-Aswad. Al-Aswad means dark, black, right? He was so dark that nobody would give the daughter to marry him. Sa'd wanted to get married and no one's giving. And Sa'd's expectations are pretty high. You know, he's expecting a Mercedes and he, alhamdulillah, why not? So somebody's asking him to get married. He said, no, I want a better girl. So he comes to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he says, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, are we not equal, the poor and the rich? And Rasulullah, why are you asking that, Sa'd? Of course, you're all equal in the sight of Allah azawajal. Ya Rasulullah, will we be the secondary ones in Jannah? No, Ya Sa'd, you will be among the first. You are among those who have sacrificed and you are among the first people, the Sahabas, you'll be among first. And Sa'd kept asking questions like this. Ya Rasulullah, is this right? And Rasulullah said, hold on, Sa'd, what's the matter? Come and tell me. Don't beat around the bush. You know, Rasulullah is smart. He's their father figure. Ma kana Muhammad aba hadam rijalakum wa kin Rasulullah wa khatam an-nabiyyin. Muhammad is not the father of your men, but he's a father figure, right? So he said, Sa'd, tell me exactly, what's your problem? He says, Ya Rasulullah, all I'm asking is, I'm a Muslim and I'm your companion. No one is marrying your daughter. No one is marrying the daughter to me. And Rasulullah said, oh, that's not the problem? Fine. Sa'd, why don't you go to that man? And this man was one of the richest men in Medina. Ask his daughter Zainab to get married to you. Now imagine Zainab, that rich man's daughter, is someone who's known for her beauty. She was called Malakul Medina. She was called one of the princes of Medina. Imagine. And Sa'd al-Aswad, Sa'd the dark, Sa'd the black, is asked by Rasulullah to go and marry. Sa'd is on cloud nine. He runs to the home, knocks, and you know, the prospective groom that you're talking about, and says, excuse me, yes, I'm here, and Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam sent me, I want to marry your daughter. And the father-in-law, the prospective father-in-law, the bride's, the, you know, the girl's father says, are you crazy? You want to marry my daughter? I mean, look at you. You're poor, you're dark, you're black. I mean, subhanAllah, no malaysia, brothers and sisters, I love, you know, but this is how the statement was framed. And Sa'd is smart. So Sa'd is dejected, but he shouts out loudly, oh, I didn't anyway had intention. Rasulullah sent me to get married to your daughter. Now imagine, Sa'd said that Rasulullah told me, and these were new Muslim. This man and his daughter were new Muslim. Immediately the daughter comes to her father and says, oh my father, what are you doing? This is not a normal proposal. It's a proposal sent by the Prophet of Allah. I am ready to marry him. Now the daughter Zainab wants to marry this man. And subhanAllah, so now what's the meher? Meher is 400 dirhams. And Sa'd goes running to Rasulullah. Ya Rasulullah, what happened, Sa'd? Rasulullah, I'm ready to get married. I don't have money. 400 dirhams, where do I get? So he, Rasulullah says to Usman ibn Talha, one of the other rich Sahabis, not Usman ibn Affan, Usman Talha and Ali ibn Abi Talib, they take up some money and they give him. So how much money now he gets? 400 dirhams. Sa'd is getting married to the princess of Medina, the most beautiful of the women out there. And here is he. As he's getting ready, the marriage is fixed absolutely on the dot. And Sa'd has 400 dirhams. He just bought some beautiful, you know, presents for the bride. And he's ready with the mehr money and he's going. And then there is an announcement. The announcement says, oh, people of Medina, oh Ansars and Muhajir, Jannah is calling you. There is a qital announced, there is a battle announced. Are you all ready to come? Now Sa'd al-Aswad is in two minds. Sa'd is not sure what to do. One day, there is his marriage he's been waiting for to this most beautiful woman, and he wants to get married. And another way, there is a battle call, a cry for joining the battle. Sa'd says it's a very simple choice. Jannah is calling me, I leave everything. He goes back to the shop. He says, please take the gifts back. Give my money back. He gets the money back. He buys a horse and a sword because he had nothing for him. And he covers himself with a naqab, a cloth, right? Now, you know, with the lockdown, all the face masks out there, so that he knows if Rasulullah recognizes him, Rasulullah will send him back. And he runs into the battlefield as if there's no tomorrow. Sa'd al-Aswad is running and fighting as if there is no tomorrow. And the Sahabas are astonished. Who is this man in the naqab whose face we can't see and is fighting? They run to Ali bin Abi Talib and say, Ali, who is this man? Ali says, don't stop him. He has only come here to get Jannah. Sa'd al-Aswad has come here for Jannah. But Sa'd, the valiant, brave Sa'd, fights and fights and fights until he's shaheed. Until he is shaheed, and all he says, Fiddaka abi wa ummi ya Rasulullah, may my parents be sacrificed for you, Rasulullah. This is what I want to live for. And as the battle has drawn to an end and the Muslims are victorious, Rasulullah, in his customary, he goes around looking at the shaheeds. He goes around at the wounded and goes around at the shaheeds who has to be now buried down. And as Rasulullah is walking, he sees this young Sa'd al-Aswad, who had just got married a day before. He had already arranged everything. He is lying there dead. As Rasulullah goes to Sa'd, he takes his head and puts it on his lap. And the Sahaba, the young Sahaba who is narrating the hadith, says, I've never seen Rasulullah do what he did. First of all, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was crying. There were tears that were falling from his eyes. And then he smiled. First he cried, then he smiled, and then he turned his face away. And the Sahaba were confused. He said, Ya Rasulullah, we've never seen you do that. I don't know what you did. Rasulullah, please explain. And Rasulullah said, my tears were for this man who wanted to get married, and Allah gave him most precious, most beautiful women from the women of my people of the world, and I was crying that he's lying here dead. But then Allah showed me the hoor and the beauty and the gifts Allah is giving him in Jannah, and I started smiling. I smiled for Sa'd. And then Allah showed me Sa'd and his wives in Jannah running towards him. And out of haya, I turned my face. My friends, my brothers and sisters, this is Sa'd al-Aswad. This is Sa'd, the one who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose a better end just for the love of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Fidaka abi wa ummi, indeed, Ya Rasulullah, may my parents be sacrificed if I can contribute this way to you. Imagine, my brothers. So the third lesson is, what have you done? How much do you know? Just knowing what Allah will give you in response to heeding the call of Rasulullah. It could be a call of saying salams. It could be call of just greeting somebody. It could be the sunnah of gifting something. When is the last time you gifted something to your own children, to neighbors, to your brothers, to your friends, to your parents? And this is a sunnah, just reviving some of the lost sunnahs, the miswak, and you know, the du'as that you do, the love of the book of hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You know, this is what you're talking about. Let your akhlaq, let your character do the talking. This is a true love. This is the most important of all the loves I'm talking about. If you really love Rasulullah and your actions are otherwise, that is not the real love. The fourth one is, what's your contribution? How are you contributing to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam's life? How can I contribute? Well, you know, one of the poets of Rasulullah, Hassan ibn Thabit radiallahu ta'ala, said something very beautiful. He said, I could not praise Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam with my words. Rather, my words were made praiseworthy by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He says, when I'm penning something, it's not my words, but because I'm penning about Rasulullah, it becomes so praiseworthy. What are you doing? There is a beautiful, you know, I read in one of the book and I love this. I had to put it across. Well, the famous pyramids of Egypt. He said, how do you stop Egyptians from fighting? You know, I've seen enough of Doha debates. And when there's an Egyptian, you see they are showstoppers, right? You have seen Egyptians. You have to see them argue. You have to see them debate. They have thrown glasses of water. They have done fist fights. They have used abusive words. They have disrespected women. No, nothing about the community. But, you know, sometimes it's said that they are the most short-tempered men and women in the world. SubhanAllah, you know, Pharaoh was from the land, so a bit of reminiscence out there. But so was Musa alayhi salam, by the way, right? Musa alayhi salam hit somebody and he died. But one of the most beautiful things I read, may Allah bless the entire country and the people, and I have some great friends out there. And SubhanAllah says, how do you stop an Egyptian from fighting? Just say the durood in front of them. Moment they're fighting and they're intense fight, say Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad, and the entire durood, and they'll stop fighting for the love and the respect of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. You can't beat that, can you? When you're intensely fighting and somebody says the durood, they stop the fight. They actually hug each other. That truly is a love of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So there we are. Inna Allah wa malaikati yusallu nabi ya ayyuhallazina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. I think this is one of the integral part of the Juma khutbahs, where how much of salam, how much of durood can you send on Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam? They are specific angels, my brothers and sisters. The moment you say durood, and angels are the ones who bring it to Rasulullah, and he replies to it from the authentic narration of Allah Azza wa Jal. There are riwayas which says your du'as are stagnating between the earth and the heaven until you say the durood on Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Imagine just the power of the durood. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama sallaita ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidun majid. Allahumma barik ala Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad kama barakta ala Ibrahim wa ala ali Ibrahim innaka hamidun majid. I mean, subhanallah, I would love to tell you more. There's so much, just the du'as that you send. You know, the durood is like a fuel. Your rocket of du'as don't go up if the fuel is not there. I mean, look at the entire ecosystem Allah has built around the masjid is nothing but having one line of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam sending salams on him. The Adhan has the Shahada of Rasulullah. Ashadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. When you do the wudu, the dua after the wudu. When you enter the masjid, there is a lakab, there is a salah on Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. The ikama has the same thing. The tashahud does not complete until ashadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. The duas around it, the masajid, when you leave, the entire ecosystem around the masjid is upon Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Ubay bin al-Qab radiallahu ta'ala came and he said, Ya Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, how much of my dua should I spend in making durood on you? You know, I do 1/4, 25% of my dua on sending salams onto you. And Rasulullah said, Ya Ubay, it'll be better if you make it a little longer, a little more. Ubay said, 50% Ya Rasulullah. He said, a little more. He said, Ya Rasulullah, 75%. And then Rasulullah said, Oh Ubay, if you send durood on me, Allah will take care of your problems and fulfill your du'as. I mean, why do you make du'a for? Allah will take care of your problem and fulfill your du'as. That is what you and I are asking, aren't we, brothers? Subhanallah. The hadith of Rasulullah says, the closest of people to me on the day of resurrection are the one who sends the most blessings on me. Now that's your closeness. That's how you are. You know, it is said the ones who are the closest to the Khatib in Jummah are the ones who will be closest to Allah Azza wa Jal under the Arsh on the day of Qiyamah. It's your choice. So my lesson number 4 of the 5 lessons is send durood on Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Especially Friday, there's a sunnah to send as much durood as you can. And that is amazing. Finally, how much do you love Rasulullah is how much do you want to be with him? You know, there's a beautiful, one of the most amazing hadith, and there's a lovely book, subhanAllah, by Sheikh Uthaymeen and Sheikh Bin Baz, which says about the biggest calamity that affected the Muslim is the passing away of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Any other calamity, even the death of your loved ones is having, you know, secondary status then to the passing away of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Now look at Rasulullah. You know, how much do you want to be with him? So this hadith of this sahabi again, who says, Ya Rasulullah, Rasulullah was so impressed with him. He said, make a dua. I'll grant a wish. Allah asks Allah to grant your wish. He said, Ya Rasulullah, I want to be with you like the way I am in dunya. And Rasulullah said, what? Help me by doing more sajdas. Help me by doing more ibadahs. You will be with the people you love. The day this hadith was revealed, you will be, the sahabas came. Anas bin Malik radiallahu ta'ala is narrating the riwayah. He says the sahabas came and said, Ya Rasulullah, we love you. We are with you in dunya. We are getting up and, eating and praying salah. But in Jannah, you have maqam and mahmood. We are far away. What will happen to us? And then the hadith came. Every person will be the one with whom he loved, true love. And they say, Anas said, it was like the day of Eid in Medina. Why? Because the Sahabas were very clear. Their heart was very clear. They truly loved Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. They truly indeed loved. Not the superficial love you and I are talking about. The hearts changed by the word of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. I can tell you stories of Umar bin Khattab or others who came to assassinate Rasulullah. You know, today some people are drawing Rasulullah and saying malicious thing. Imagine people want to kill Rasulullah. Just the words change him. Why are you not telling the words of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam? People, there was a man who came and he said, Rasulullah, and Rasulullah is sitting under a tree and the man has a sword in his hand and he says, Oh Muhammad, who will save you now from me? And Rasulullah looks at him with all demeanor, calmness. He said, Allah. And the man says, what? He says, Allah. He said, no, who? Allah. Third time his sword falls from the hand. Rasulullah picks up the sword and says, now tell me who will save you. And the man says, Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah. He knows there's no other escape and he embraces. Just the words, the yaqeen, the tawakkul in Rasulullah, the way he had. I tell you three beautiful words. Rasulullah, as we say, it's a chuma and the mimbar is there. And as you're climbing the mimbar, Rasulullah made three duas. It could be the blessing or the curse of Rasulullah. If you truly love Rasulullah, this is what you do. The first one, he said, Ameen. And the second, he said, Ameen. And the third, he said, Ameen. And the Sahaba said, Ya Rasulullah, what was this Ameen all about? And he said, Jibreel came and says, curse be on someone who have his parents who are old and they don't, you know, he doesn't get Jannah because of serving them. And he said, Ameen. So they are your Jannah. You love Rasulullah, show that on your parents. Love them unconditionally. Then he said, Ameen. He said, what is the second Ameen about? He says, when you have the month of Ramadan and you've not prepared enough for it and you're not seek blessing and you're not come out as if you should be coming out. And he said, Ameen. And I said, 100 days to Ramadan now. And the third one, what was the third Ameen about? And he said, third Ameen was all about Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. When his name is being mentioned and you don't send salams on him, the curse been upon that man. Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And you fulfill that obligation. My brothers and sisters, these are the five ways you love Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. I hope this has touched some corner of your heart, something about it, alhamdulillah. I quickly recap what I just said. The journey of true love is knowing him, catching attention, missing someone, what's your contribution, and the fifth, together forever. We spoke a lot of things, but I could not recap. But I recap about knowing Rasulullah, at least know the names Allah gave him. Know the names of Ummahatul Mu'mineen, the Ashra Mubashira, the people around him, his Sahabas, and the genealogy or the lineage of Rasulullah. Read the Quran. Juz Amma, as I said, the Juz is the seerah of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. We spoke about Umar and the love around him. What have you done? How much do you love Rasulullah? Love the books of the Hadith. When there's an argument and somebody presents an authentic riwayah, accept it. That's truly a love of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And remember, when his name is mentioned, send salams and blessings. 95-100% of your duas, if you send, it is absolutely okay because Allah is taking care of it. All good is from Allah Azza wa Jal. All mistakes are mine. Inna Allah wa malaikati yusallu nabi ya ayyuhallazina amanu sallu alayhi wa sallimu taslima. Oh, inshallah ta'ala. Jazakallah khair. Subhanallah wa bihamdi. Subhanakallah wa bihamdika. Ashhadu la ilaha illa anta astaghfiruka wa atubu alayk.